Proclamation. We'll start today's service with a proclamation. We ask that you prepare your heart and pay attention for the next hour or so. Let's prepare our heart for today's service. Matthew 11:5. The blind will receive sight, and the lame will walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And let us prepare our hearts for today's praise and worship, and give time to today's leader, Bruce Chen.
Hello, church. It's good to see you guys here this morning. Let's do a quick prayer before we start our worship. Dear God, we come before you with a thankful heart. Lord, it's because of you that we're able to gather here together to worship you. Lord, during this tough time, we want to declare that you are good, you're still faithful, and during this tough time, we want to say that you are our rock, so we can stand firm in your words and in you. Lord, as we prepare our hearts, would you fill this place? Would your spirit come and fill our hearts as well? Lord, may what we sing, what we play, be pleasing to you. We want to lift you up this morning. We want to give you all the praises and all the worship to you. Thank you. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
To you our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden, you are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God, let your fire fall down. To you our hearts, to you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden, you are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God, let your fire fall down.
We are here for you. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is a very love that you would take my place.
Be seated. We'd like to welcome new friends joining us. And this is your first time joining us. This is our website, whether you're from 1.5 Gen or you're looking for English ministry. These are our church website and our ministry website. And also we invite you to please join our Facebook group, as that's the place that we make announcements these days. So whether you're from 1.5 Gen or EM, please join our Facebook group or like our Facebook page. And if this is your first time, we also invite you to please scan the QR code and leave your information with us. And don't worry, we're not going to spam you with stuff. We just want to see if we can help you to find a suitable small group for you to join. So if you can, please use your cell phone to scan this QR code, and doesn't matter which congregation you are from, we will pass the information to the right congregation and to the right group. And during this time, if you need prayer, you can either talk to me, Kitty, Casey, or Sam, or you can write to our 1.5 Gen prayer team email, and our prayer team would love to pray for you during this time. Next, we'll continue with announcements, and this is what I saw on internet. Again, we start with announcement with kind of a joke today. So this is what I saw on the internet. Remember that one girl from high school that says she only go out with you if the world is ending? Well, this may be the year to give her a call. All right, so today's announcement, our QT, our quality time, extend through the month of August. So if you want to join our QT, here is the Zoom ID, and Pastor Casey will be there to lead every week, Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 8 a.m., so on weekdays. You don't have to speak English. Any language you're comfortable with is fine, okay? Next is we continue to remind you that our Saturday, we have our children's service, elementary and early childhood, so please contact the ministry coworker if you and your kids are interested. Last Sunday, we had a small group leader, the technique training, and we talked about how to play games and activity on Zoom. And if you miss it, we do have the recording, so just use your phone to scan the QR code. It will lead you to a the Google Drive folder and has the recording, so you can go ahead and listen to it. If you are a small group leader and if you miss it, this is mandatory for you to go watch the recording. Next, we want to spend some time to pray for the nations. At 1.5 Generation, at each month, our coworker prayer meeting, we used to pray for a nation. Now, since the pandemic, we kind of have stopped, but I think it's good that we bring this back, this tradition, so that our whole congregation is aware of praying for all nations. So we're not just focusing on ourselves. We are praying for the countries around us. All right, so today I picked a nation, Brazil. Now, I picked Brazil because it's one, other than U.S., that's the worst COVID-19 hit country. So here are some facts about Brazil. 1822 gained its independence from Portugal, so Portuguese is the main language. The population is about 215 million. Now, most of the Brazilians are quote-unquote Christian, but 47 of the 323 people group are either least rich or unreached, meaning they are not capable of evangelizing to their, within their own people group. Now, most of the Brazilians are Christians and mostly are Catholic, but there's about 20 to 25% evangelical Christians. However, there are many indigenous people group and still other religions like Muslim group. They still need the gospel in this nation. Now, some prayer points for the nation of Brazil. Number one is nominalism, meaning that they're just by name. They're just Christian by name. They don't really practice their faith. They're just nominal Christian, 名义上的, 表面上的基督徒. So that's one thing we should definitely pray for this nation. However, we are seeing a revival within the evangelical Christian in Brazil, so continue to pray for the church. The other prayer points are Brazil has a very huge wealth gap, poverty, drug, and political corruption. Those are the prayer points that we should definitely pray for Brazil. And it's also one of the hardest COVID hit countries, as I've mentioned. Up to today, there's 2.6 million tested positive and 92,000 plus death. So we'd like to spend a minute and in front of your TV or phone, and let's pray for Brazil. So Father, I come before you, I want to pray for the nation of Brazil, even though this is quote-unquote a Christian country, but many of the people still need you. And Father, I pray for revival within this nation. I pray for revival within the churches of Brazil. I pray that you reach out to the indigenous people group. And I pray that you change the heart of those nominal Christians. I pray that people with faith do have passion and live out their faith. And Father, I pray for the political and social issues of Brazil, whether it's drug, whether it's political corruption, whether it's poverty. Father, I pray that you have mercy. And Father, I pray that you change the heart, you transform the heart of leaders so that they actually care for people. And Father, I also pray for the COVID-19 situation. And it is very severe in this nation. And Father, I pray for mercy within Brazil. Father, I pray for natural and supernatural healing. And you watch over this land and you continue to watch over those who are poor and you provide them with good health care and provide them with financial need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, and this is also a reminder that at the end of today's service, we'll have communion. So please prepare your heart and prepare the material as we'll have communion at the end of today's service. We'll continue worship with offering, and offering is a duty for Christian and Christian only. So if you're not a Christian, please don't feel obligated to give. And if you are a Christian, if you attend EFCI, please prepare your heart and also please prepare and take tithe seriously. And you can either mail your check or you can scan the QR code and to make your offering online. Let's pray. Father, I want to pray for everyone at EFC Irvine. I pray that you continue to provide, you continue to take care of us. And Father, I also pray that you help us to use the money wisely. And we give thanks to you, and may you also be the head of our church and continue to be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, good morning, everyone. And this year, the church has been using the Gospel of John to talk about how Jesus is the light of the world and how Jesus can continue to work in our life. So if you can go to if you can get your Bible and go to John chapter 9, and today we're going to talk about John chapter 9, verse 1 through 11. What do you see? And this is actually the same message that I spoke at 1.5 Gen last week. So if you have seen this message from last week, then this week at 1.5 Gen, I'll be speaking part two of this message. So you can go to that if you already heard this message last week from 1.5 Gen. And I encourage you to still have your own Bible or iPad and not just relying on my PowerPoint. All right, so let's dive into John chapter 9. But I want to start with what are the first three words you see from this scramble. So I'll give you a minute, and you can look at your phone or TV and find the first three words you see. Now, this is not like a fortune telling or personality test. Right, this is something just random. Okay, I'm just using this as a demo. So whatever words you see, I'm sure God can speak to you, but not necessarily meaning it's the word that God wants you to see. Okay. So I hope that's enough time for everyone to find three words. All right, so I'll share with mine. Mine is family, breakthrough, and change. In that order, that's the three words I see. Well, today's passage, I want to talk about seeing. I want to talk about seeing things just like everyone's looking at the same picture here, but we may all see different things because we may all have different focus and different perspective. So even though everyone's seeing the same picture here, I'm sure people are getting three different words because you'll have different focus and different perspective. So today I want to talk about what do you see from John chapter 9. Let's begin with verse 1. And today's passage is in NASB, but you can read the version that you are more comfortable with. Verse 1, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he would be born blind? Verse 3, Jesus answered, it was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it was so that the work of God might be displayed in him. So the first point I want to talk about today is from recipient of punishment into vessel of God's work. So the passage that the verse that we just read in verse 2, the disciples asked Jesus, saying, Rabbi, who sinned? Is this man or his parents? Now, we often ask the same question. Why do bad things happen to good people? Or why do bad things happen to me? Or am I being punished by God? Or was this a result of sin? And also, we often ask the question, why? Why does this happen? Now, I think why is a lot of question that many of us struggle a lot recently. Why does God allow COVID-19 to happen? Why does God allow good people to suffer and even die? And why do some people behave this way and maybe contributed to the pandemic, and yet there's no punishment to them, or at least we haven't seen it. So we all ask a lot of questions. We all ask why and what happened recently. Now, at that time, in Jesus' time, the theology at that time is relatively more black and white. Okay? And this is from the Old Testament. Their view of suffering and disease in general is because people's sin. So it's very black and white theology. So at that time, when people have disease, or people who die early, or people who have handicap, it's viewing as God's punishment as a result of sin. So when they see this blind person, it's very easy. They're asking, it's very normal, they're asking this question, is it because of his sin, or is it because of a generational sin, that his parents sinned? So this is the theology that they all have coming from inheriting the theology of Old Testament. So for example, in 2 Chronicles chapter 26, this is a king, King Uzziah. King Uzziah, with a censer in his hand of burning incense, was enraged. And while he was enraged with the priest, the leprosy broke out on his forehead before the priest in the house of the Lord, beside the altar of the incense. So King Uzziah, he's not supposed to give offering. That's for the priest to do. Yet he did it because of his pride. And at that time, immediately, he started to have leprosy. Verse 21, King Uzziah was a leper to the day of his death, and he lived in a separate house, being a leper, for he was cut off from the house of the Lord. So see very clearly, the theology in the Old Testament is if you sin, you will have sickness. You will be sick. So that's the mentality or the theology people had at that time. Now, of course, today, a lot of us kind of have that theology as well, that if someone is sick, maybe it's God's punishment. If you make a lot of money, maybe it's God's blessing. Now, of course, suffering, pain, suffering, and disease, it is possible it's God's punishment, but it's not 100%. It's not always the reason. So here, Jesus challenged the worldview here. Jesus saying, no, this is not the case. It's not because of his sin. It's not because of the generational sin. It is because, in verse 3, Jesus said, it is so that the work of God might be displayed in him. So Jesus said the reason, but we're not sure if this is a reason. It's actually a very, very interesting reason. Because Jesus' answer actually gave rise to another issue, another problem. It seems like, you know, God intentionally made this person blind and to show that God is a powerful God. This make God kind of very evil, right? Like you know, we are God's pawn on the chessboard, right? We're very, very low status. Like, God made this person blind to show off his power. Almost seemed like this way. So this is what I want to talk about, the first point. What does Jesus see? Jesus saw a vessel of God's work. From the perspective of the disciples, they were judging, they were gossiping about this blind man. Now, a lot of times we're like the blind man because things don't turn out the way we desire, and sometimes others' opinion may hurt us even more to make the situation even worse. But how does Jesus or God look at this? What does Jesus see here? God sees this person as a vessel that can display God's work. So instantly, a blind man, a man being maybe being looked at as a sinner and being punished by God, instantly his status rise from a sinner to God's vessel, from a man who is a vessel can display God's glory, from a man who's being looked down by others, being judged by others as sinner, rise out to be a man that who can be a messenger for the creator of the universe. So the reason Jesus said this actually is not because men's status are low. We're just, you know, being there to show off God's power. No, Jesus instantly elevated this guy's status from a sinner that everyone was judging him all the way up here to a vessel that can the vessel of God's glory, to be a vessel of the creator of the universe. So God is actually changing us the way we see things. Jesus is challenging our perspective. Stop judging this person. Stop gossiping about this person. Seeing this person as the vessel of the Almighty God. Jesus is changing the way we see things. Jesus is challenging our perspective. So in fact, Jesus probably didn't really tell us the reason why he was blind. He didn't really answer the question. Just like many things in our life that we don't have the reason, that God doesn't really answer our question. You know, we may have all these questions on why, but Jesus didn't really answer it. It's very common. Jesus didn't really answer the why. Instead, he wants us to see things from a totally different perspective. Now, recently, because of the Black Lives Matter movement, one of the story that became famous is Archie Williams' story. So let us watch a short clip from YouTube, and this is Archie Williams' story. He was in prison for 37 years for a sin, for a crime that he did not commit. So let's watch this clip.
My name is Archie Williams.
Tuesday night, Archie Williams took the stage on NBC's America's Got Talent and made an impression no one will soon forget.
Don't let the sun go down on me.
A show-stopping moment that he never could have imagined just last year. On March 21st, 2019, Archie Williams was released from Angola Prison in Louisiana, 37 years after being falsely accused and convicted of rape.
Bittersweet moment right now.
Archie was just 22 in 1983 when he was arrested and stood trial for the 1982 rape and stabbing of a white woman in her Baton Rouge home. Despite multiple alibis, fingerprints that didn't match his, and eyewitnesses saying Archie wasn't the guy, he was convicted and sentenced to life in prison with no possibility of parole.
Being innocent is a thing where you never give up on yourself.
That kept Archie going, and in 1995, after having already served 12 years, he wrote to the Innocence Project. By the grace of God, I'm still holding on, hoping and praying someone will answer my letter.
His case was screaming out that he was innocent.
It took a new judge in 2019 to order the fingerprint test. Within 8 hours, they'd found the real rapist. And within a week, Archie was free.
What does freedom feel like, Archie?
I don't think you can explain it. The fullness of freedom.
For Archie, this is what freedom sounds like.
Found your voice.
Singing was my sport.
That sport led him to an unusual place.
I was just incarcerated for 37 years for somebody else's crime.
Ooh. 37 years of pain and suffering, and now joy in each note.
But losing everything is like the sun going down.
Words that much more powerful coming from Archie.
I will never ever listen to that song in the same way ever again.
One person influenced my life, and that was Oprah. And I remember her saying to me, if you're in a position to make television shows, you have the ability to change people's lives.
And because of Archie, he's become an ambassador for the Innocence Project.
We're going to do something about this together, because I believe that when enough people unite, great things happen.
They say the truth will set you free. For Archie, it's done more than that. It's given him back his life, including a daughter he didn't know he had.
To think of her going all those years without me.
And a future with new dreams.
I want to make up all the lost years.
It's like the sun going down.
All right. Now, I'm sure he had a lot of questions. He had a lot of why, how come, is it fair? We may also have a lot of questions. Why? We also have a lot of questions about our circumstances, our experience. And we may get stuck in how do other people see us, or how do we see these things? But Jesus changed our perspective. Jesus wants to change our perspective. Jesus said, so it was so that the work of God might be displayed in you, in all of you. So Jesus is changing the angle to God's angle and help us to see things, to see people from a totally different perspective, to elevate our status, to elevate our status to God's vessel, not to be a person punished by God, but to elevate us to God's vessel. So the action item is change perspective. I want you to think about in what way the work of God can be displayed in you. The bad things that happen in your life, the why that you never understand, the things that you are going through. But in what way the work of God can display in you, can display in me, just like it displayed in Archie Williams. So that's the first action item I want to challenge you. Let's continue to dive into the story. Jesus said something seemingly relevant, but somewhat relevant. In verse 4, Jesus continued to say, "We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And continuing in verse 6, when Jesus had said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and applied the clay to his eyes and said to him, to the blind man, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which translated sent. So he went away and washed and came back seeing. Now this is kind of not easy to understand. But if we go back to verse 3, then we can probably retranslate this a little bit. So verse 3 often is being translated, understood as the reason of his blindness. However, we can also see in verse 3, you know, a possible translation by a lot of biblical scholars saying this may not be the reason this of why he is blind. This is actually providing a reason why we should do work as soon as possible. So it can also be translated like this. Jesus' answer was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but for the work of God to be displayed in him, we must work the work of him who sent me as long as it is day. So a lot of the biblical scholar is saying, Jesus is saying, for the work of God to display in him, we must do work as soon as possible. We must seize the opportunity to do work. So Jesus is not saying this is the reason why he was blind. Jesus is saying this is the reason we need to do God's work, to display, to have the glory of God display in people. That's why we need to move out and do work. And this can be one of the way we look at this passage. And so that's why in verse 6 and 7, it talks about being sent. And it's fitting that Siloam meaning sent, because we are sent to do God's work. So the second point I want us to talk about is, what do you see? Jesus saw limitation, but he didn't see it as limitation. He saw it as opportunity. So that's why in verse 3, Jesus said, "For the work of God to be displayed in him, therefore we must work." You see all these contrasts here, blindness versus light, night versus day, sin versus God's work. And all these contrasts is giving us the sense of urgency that we need to do God's work. Jesus said, "The night is coming." Now, we're not sure what exactly Jesus is referring to when he talks about night. It can be the moment Jesus was crucified on the cross, can be the moment persecution comes to church, can be the moment when power of darkness reigns in this world, and can mean our personal death, or can mean the end of the world. We're not sure what exactly Jesus meant. But we know that all the negative terms represent limitations. He was born blind, which is the hardest to heal. People were judging him, including Jesus' disciples. The enemy trying to find Jesus at fault. The night is coming, the darkness is coming, the power of darkness is coming to be in control. All these bad situations, Jesus is saying, all these limitations, there's a contrast to that, that we must work, that we must seize the opportunity to work. And Jesus is saying we. Jesus is not saying he must work. Jesus is saying we must work, as in every one of us. All these bad situations, all this limitation, danger, risk, enemies work, all these criticism, that didn't stop Jesus and shouldn't stop you and me. Because that means we must do God's work while there's still a chance. The opportunity does not last. Our life will end one day. And because of death, that gives life meaning and urgency. If we can live forever, we lose that urgency. Jesus said he is the light of the world, so he needs to do God's work. But he also said we must do God's work, because remember, Jesus also said in Matthew 5 that we are the light of the world also. So we also need to do God's work in a timely manner, and there's urgency for us to display God's work. So I want to share with you a story, and this is a story that most 1.5 generation people knew. This is a picture that we took in MCF, that our 1.5 Gen College group, this past Chinese New Year, I think in February maybe. And we had a visitor. Someone brought a friend from who's studying in North Carolina, and his name is Ted. So this is Ted, and he befriended with one of our 1.5 generation college student named Jaden. So Ted lives in North Carolina. He came to visit during Chinese New Year, attended our Chinese New Year event, and became a really good friend with Jaden, because Jaden also studied in North Carolina before. Now, Ted is not a Christian. I believe he came to 1.5 Gen that Sunday. It's probably his first time to a Sunday service. And I still remember vividly. He's a very nice kid. He came to me afterwards saying that he really enjoyed my message. He would love to come to visit our church in the future when there's opportunity. That afternoon, he was flying back to North Carolina. He was flying back to his school. And he asked me if, you know, he can have a mask for his flight. Remember, that's the time when COVID-19 was just coming along, and that Sunday I was making an announcement that for our usher team and worship team, if you need a mask, we can give usher team masks for free. So that Sunday after service, he came to me and asked if he can have a mask for his flight. So I remember I gave him two masks for him to take his flight. Beginning of July, which is last month, Jaden told me that Ted was found dead in his apartment. Now, we still don't know what happened. We still don't know the cause. I do have both Jaden and Ted's uncle's consent to share this unfortunate story with all of you. This story tells us that we need to seize the opportunity, because we don't have... The daytime is not always here. If I knew it was the last time that I'll ever see Ted again, if I knew it was the last time that afternoon, I probably would have spent more time talking to him. I probably wouldn't take my meeting as my top priority. I would spend more time talking to Ted if I knew that was the last time. And similarly, today our college group cannot meet anymore. And not only they couldn't meet anymore, before COVID-19, they regularly have 30 to 40 people, sometimes even 50 and even more with special event. And now they're down to 3 to 4 people. Almost all the students went back to Asia since everything is online, and their parents don't want them to stay here. So not only we cannot do campus outreach, not only we don't have the opportunity to share the gospel, we don't even have a regular fellowship now. We're down to like 3 to 4 people because everyone's in Asia now. We don't know what will change. We don't know what can happen. But we know we don't have all day. There will be darkness. There will be end of daylight. There will be times that we cannot do God's work anymore because we don't know what time change will come. Just like situation with Ted or with our 1.5 Gen College group. Things can just happen and daylight no more. The night has come and you don't have the opportunity to do it. So the second thing is Jesus saw all these limitation to be opportunity. Jesus said, let's seize the opportunity. Let's do work as much as possible while there's still daylight. So the action item, the second action item is we need to learn from Jesus and to see the opportunity and to seize the opportunity. COVID-19 presented a lot of limitations around us. But maybe there are also new opportunity for us to see. There are people for you to care about, people for you to talk to. Maybe there are new friends or new ministry. So I encourage you, the second action item is to see the opportunity and also to seize the opportunity. Don't see things as limitation, but see it as opportunity. The third point of what do you see is transformation. Do you see the problem that you were born with, or do you see the power of transformation in Jesus? The story began with there's a man born blind, and Jesus saw him. He was born with blindness. In verse 6, he starts seeing. Now he can see. Now, the Greek word used here is blepo, and I'll come back to this, you know, hold on to this thought. I'll come back to this later. I want to remind everyone that Jesus has the power to transform, that Jesus has the power to, the supernatural power to transform. Oftentimes we live in this world, we forget that Jesus is supernatural. We focus on our problems. We focus on natural things. We focus on technology, logic, but we forget that Jesus is a supernatural God. So I want to share with you this clip. And can I ask the AV coworker to play this clip? Now, this clip is a story, and it's a true story. It's actually the story told by me, told to me by my elementary school classmates. She shared this with me because her husband is Pastor Jonathan in Taiwan, who was the translator that night. So she told me the story first, and I found this YouTube. This YouTube was about a Kingdom Culture conference. I think this is Pastor Randy Clark. So that's watch this video.
Oh, somebody just called in. They got healed by the telephone. They could not swallow, and now they can.
刚才有人打电话过来分享见证, 就是他们本来不能够吞, 但是他们现在可以了。
Go get the test right there. Listen to this.
我们有一个两岁半的小男孩, 他的名字叫做Oscar, 他没有办法吞咽, 他没有那个本能, 他不能吞咽, 本来一直要用 他用胃管鼻胃管，然后刚刚我们打电话给他，他妈妈说他第一次能够吞咽，然后没有呛到，感谢赞美主。Okay, we have a little 2.5-year-old boy named Oscar, and he has no swallowing reflex, so he had all those tubes. And we prayed for over the phone. We called the mom over the phone and prayed for him. Oh. And he was swallowing for the first time, and he didn't choke. Praise God.
No, wait. What's his name?
Oscar.
How do you
mean? What do I have written there?
他上面写的名字就是 Oscar. 牧师上面写的名字就是 Oscar. 这上面写的就是 Oscar.
Call him and tell him. Watch it. We had the name Oscar. I was going to call out the name Oscar.
牧师在祷告之前就领受这个名字 Oscar.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Go back to the.
Thank you, Jesus.
感谢耶稣。
I don't know if you have done treasure hunt, but so Pastor Randy Clark, so before this healing conference, God already told him, he already wrote the name Oscar, which is not a common name, and trouble swallowing. And that day or that night, there's a boy who was born with this problem, trouble swallowing things since birth, and his name is Oscar. And he got healed that night. And we have to remember that Jesus is a supernatural God. And he has the power to heal us. He has the power to transform us, even though it's a tough thing that we were born with. But Jesus has the power to overcome that. We see that this person, he was born with blindness. And we all have problems that we are born with. Maybe you're not blind, and maybe you don't have trouble swallowing. But you have other problems that came from birth. Maybe there are other problems that there are physical sickness. Maybe there are things that you don't like about yourself. Maybe it's your ability. Maybe it's your temper. Maybe it's your personality, maybe it's your fear. There are things that you don't like about yourself, and you think you can never overcome, you can never change. But Jesus says something different. Jesus said, but God's work, the work of God will be on you. Jesus said, you are a vessel that can be manifested for the glory of God. Jesus said he has a power to transcend. He has a power to change. And Jesus is saying God can help you to be different. God can change you and God can transform you. And it doesn't matter what you were born with. It doesn't matter the disabilities, the things you didn't like, the things that always bother you since birth, or maybe your family of origin that you didn't like. It doesn't matter. And God said God has the power to transform and transcend all that because God's word can be displayed in you. There are things that maybe, you know, since you have memory, you always like this. You've always been like this. The things that you didn't like, the things that you couldn't overcome. But Jesus said, I can help you to overcome. At the end of this story in verse 8, therefore, the neighbors and those who previously saw him as a beggar were saying, is not this the one who used to sit and beg? Others were saying, this is he. Still others were saying, no, but he is like him. He kept saying, I am the one. So they were saying to him, how then were your eyes open? He answered, the man who was called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. So I went away and washed, and I received sight. Now the word receive sight in Greek, the original language, is ana blepo. Blepo means see. Ana means actually restore sight. This word is mainly used for people who could see before, but something happened. They couldn't see, but they got healed, so they restored their sight so they could see again. This is usually used for someone who could see before. Now they restore their sight. But remember, he was born blind. He never had sight. How could it be restored? But the Bible still used that word, restore sight. Because remember, in the beginning, when God created us, when there's no sin, and when there's no disease, there's no blindness, there's no death, God created you and I, God created men to be perfect. And it is when we leave God, we left that perfectness and we start to have all these issues. So what Jesus is saying here, I can restore that order. Whatever you are born with, I could restore that order. To the original order when I first created you in the Garden of Eden. So even with the things that we were born with, the problem and struggle, God is capable of restoring order in your life. Maybe it sounds difficult, but we have to remember God is a supernatural God. God is capable of restoring order in your life. In the very beginning, I asked you this. What are the first three words you see? Now, the same picture, everyone sees different things, different words, different reality. But I believe God wants you to see things in a new perspective, to see what God sees. So I made an acronym. The first thing is, do we see people as God's vessel? Do you see yourself as God's vessel? Not as someone being punished, but as God's vessel. God wants to elevate our status. And the second thing is, there's opportunity. We have to see it and we have to seize it. So do you see the opportunity? The third one is T, transformation. We all have problems that came with our birth, that we were born with, that we could never get rid of. But God is saying, I have the power to transform you. I have the power to make changes in your life. Trust me, I'm willing to transform your life. Let's pray. Father, I want to pray for everyone here and help us to see things differently. Help us to see what you see. You see people as God's vessel. You see limitations as opportunity. And you see problems as, you don't see problems. You see problems as you're capable of transforming them. And Father, I want to pray for all my brother and sister, whatever problem we are going through or whatever problem that came as we were born with. Father, I pray that you lay hands on them and help them to be transformed. Help them to be renewed. Help them to trust that you are a God of supernatural and you're capable, you're willing to make changes in their life. Help them to make progress. Help them to deal with it. Help them to start to deal with the problem that they have. And Father, also help us to see different opportunities, especially during COVID-19. And help us to seize these opportunities. And God, I also pray that you help us to see each other and see ourselves as God's vessel. So we're not judging. We're not just seeing problems. We're not just gossiping. But we see every single brother and sister around us as God's vessel. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue with Holy Communion. And today is the first Sunday of this month. So we're going to observe communion. 所以如果可以的话，你可以预备好你的圣餐。So we're going to observe Holy Communion together. And Holy Communion was said on the night Jesus was betrayed. On the night Jesus was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "The cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Now, of course, we're missing a part of one element of communion is we don't see each other. We don't commune with each other. We don't fellowship with each other. But in many ways, it helps us to emphasize, to enhance the other element, which is in remembrance of Jesus Christ. 纪念主耶稣为我们做的。 We don't have another service after. We don't need to pick up kids. We don't need to do social. We don't need to have worship. We don't need to have meeting. So let us remember what Jesus has done for us. We invite those of you who are Christian to join us. So if you confess your faith, we invite you to partake the communion together. On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So the bread is like the body of Jesus Christ, which died for us, broken for us. So whenever we take the communion, we remember that Jesus' body died for us. He died for us on the cross for our sin, so that we may be redeemed. Let us take the bread together. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." So the cup represents the blood of Jesus, which has shed for us. So whenever we drink the cup, we also remember what Jesus has done for us. So we take the bread and the cup to remember that he died for our sin. This is a good opportunity for us to do some self-examination, to go through our month, to go through our week, go through our day. What have we done that offended God? What are the sin that we have done? And we pray for forgiveness. And also we give thanks that Jesus has died on the cross, that his body broken for us, his blood shed for us. So this is also a time for thanksgiving. And lastly, even though we're not physically together, so we take the bread and the cup as it were communion, we're also praying for our church, that we're in one spirit, one fellowship. That doesn't matter what language, which ministry we go to, what language we use. It reminds us that we're baptized with the same water, the same spirit, and Jesus Christ is the head of our church. Let us pray. Father, again, we give thanks for you. Thank you for dying on the cross for each one of us. Thank you for your body broken for us and your blood shed for us. As we remember what you have done for us, we give thanks. And we cannot repay what you have done for us, but help us to examine the sin and iniquity that we have done. And help us to give thanks to everything you have done for us. And help us to continue to have breakthrough relationship with you. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And let us stand for benediction as we close. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of our Heavenly Father and the fellowship and guidance of the Holy Spirit be with all my brothers and sisters until we see you again. Amen.